Everyone, it's 5 minutes after 2, so we are scheduled to continue. I hope everybody is back. I'm Hendrik. I'm a member of the HPC team here at GWDG, and I have the pleasure to talk and work with you on parallelization with Python for the rest of the day, so for the next 4 hours. The entire part of parallelization with Python is scheduled in 2 blocks. First of all, we will look at single node parallelization. We have approximately 1 hour lecture on this. Afterwards, again, approximately 1 hour hands-on tutorial. Then we have a short break at around 4 p.m. and then we will have yet another approximately 1 hour lecture followed by another 1 hour practical. If you have any question, please just write in the chat or unmute yourself and go ahead and ask, no problem, at any time. And I will just start with the content now. So, as mentioned, first of all, we will look at single node parallelization with Python, and as part of this course, we will really cover the basics of this idea. And with this, we have 2 different options. We have multi-threading, which uses subtasks in your Python interpreter and can use several CPUs. However, it shares the same memory, and this requires a proper memory synchronization. And this is where something called the global interpreter lock comes into play, which takes care that this memory synchronization actually takes place. A different option is called multiprocessing. And here each process which we spawn will have its own memory, and these processes run completely independent from each other. Yeah, some say it's more stable, but you have some additional overhead, but this is actually not the key difference. So the key difference is the global interpreter lock, which we'll cover in this lecture. So first of all, we start with multi-threading. Short hint, there are 2 modules, thread and threading. If you see something which uses thread, so import thread, you can forget it because it's very old and it's not even supported in Python 3. So you can skip any Stack Overflow page that you see there. The threading module provides a few nice functions based on thread objects. So you can always look up the active count of thread objects that you have currently active. You can get the current thread where this function is called in, and you can also enumerate across your threads, and then you get a list of all thread objects that are currently active. Okay, now I've talked about the thread object. How do we actually create one? We are using the threading module as mentioned, and then we just use the thread class, which is defined in the threading module. We have a target. This needs to be a function, and we can also provide arguments for this function. Please note that we need to have an iterable here for our arguments. So for instance, if you have only 1 argument, let's say 1 integer, and you would just have 1 in here, this is an int, not an iterable, you will get a corresponding exception from your interpreter. This is just a thread object. Of course, I hope you are all familiar with the concept of object-oriented programming. And in order to make from this object, which is now probably living in your main thread or some other thread, to spawn a new thread instance which is running in your on your system, we need to start the thread with thread.start. Yeah, and by calling this, we are now executing on our system a new thread, which executes the function f with two different variables. So if we look at a very simple example, how this can look. So we are importing the threading module. We are defining a function, my function, which takes two arguments, a and b, and then it prints it multiplies a and b and then prints the result of it. And we want to calculate this in two threads. So we are creating two thread objects, thread one and thread two. We are using threading.thread, and then the target is, of course, our function here, which we want to execute in a separate thread. And we are providing here the arguments for our function, for our call. Yeah. In this case, you want to have the result of 2 × 3 and 4 × 6. And then, of course, we need to start the threads here. So it's, I think, quite simple. The thread class, which we just saw, in this case requires a target, which we use to spawn a thread instance on our interpreter. However, we can also inherit from that class, and then we can write everything that we want to execute in a parallel thread within this derived thread class. The methods of the threading.thread class, it has, of course, a dunda init, which is used for initialization, and it has a function called run. And this method, this run method, contains the code that the thread should execute when it's being created. Yeah. And you should not confuse it with the start function. Yeah, because the start function, as we just saw on the previous slide, is used to actually start, instantiate a thread. And when this thread is instantiated and it's there, it's existing, it starts to compute what is defined in the run function here. Yeah. You also have a function called join. This waits then for the thread to terminate. So probably until it has finished its computation. You can also check whether it's alive, so whether the thread is still executing. And you can also set a name and get a name for a thread. If you want to write your own subclass, so if you want to inherit from the threading.thread class and define your own thread class, you only need to and should override the dunda init and the run method. Yeah, you don't want to define the start function, because then you actually need to take care to instantiate a new or the instantiation of a new thread on the Python interpreter. This is very difficult. You should not touch this. Yeah, you should only use dunda init and run. And how could this look in action? So we import threading, and in this case, time. Then we define a new class, in this case, my thread, and we inherit from threading.thread. We have our dunda init class, yeah, which is a constructor if you're coming from the C++ world, for instance. And here we are passing in three arguments, thread ID, name, and counter. Before we now do anything for initialization of our own subclass, we are calling the initialization function, the dunda init of the superclass, yeah, of threading.thread. So it now takes care of all these things that are running under the hood. And only after this, we can now start to cover our own things that we want to set up. Yeah, like for instance, to assign a thread ID to an object attribute with the same name, and the same also for the name and the counter. Now we are defining the run method. This is, again, this is the function which defines the code which is executed when the thread is being instantiated and starts running. And then it has a short print statement saying its name. It will print the name and the counter, and it will then exit. We have also, we see here we have a function print time, so we can, within this class, MyThread, we can also define new functions in order to write cleaner code, and we can call it in here. This is no problem. We have done this with a function print time, which takes the thread name, the counter, and the delay, and we have a loop here. So while the counter is larger or equal than zero, I believe it's equal, we sleep for the delay time, then we print the name and the time, and then we decrease or decrement the counter by one. And now the thing what we have to do is we have to create two threads, thread one and thread two, and we start them. And then we print here exiting the main thread, right? And this looks on the terminal then like this. So we are starting the thread one, we are starting thread number two, and then we see these two things here, right? This is happening in the main thread, and then the main thread continues running. So these new threads, which we have already started, did not yet do any computation. Here we see here, then we are exiting the main thread. And then thread one takes over, prints the time, then thread two, then again thread one, thread two, thread one, then thread one is exiting, and then thread two, 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 and then it's also exiting. So you see it's also not ordered, so each thread can run and print print the time here, which is basically what this function is doing. If you have this set up, as I've shown before, you can also use threading.enumerate, and then you can loop over each element of this iterable, and then you can see all the threads that are currently running and which are currently active. So if we would put in this line of code, before the last line, so before this print exiting main thread, you would then see that we have three threads which are active, the main thread, and then two instances of my thread. And one remark, there will always be something called main thread. Okay, synchronizing threads. The synchronization needed for threads that depends on each other, of course, requires communication between the threads. And for this, we have two options. The maybe more complicated one is using event objects. So we have a class threading.event, and it provides the functions set and clear, and you have this threading.event class has an internal flag which you can set to true or false, and set and clear will do exactly this. You can check the state of this flag by using isSet, and you can also then call on this event, you can call the wait function, and this blocks further processing of this thread until another thread then calls the set method, right? So that it can stop this blocking, what you achieve here. And yeah, so it basically put to sleep, or you can do a wait T that you only wait for T seconds, and then you can probe again whether it's safe for you to run or not. Yeah, so wait with no arguments, is then called again to life by the interpreter, and with wait T, you have to do this probing yourself. So we have here one example of a thread which uses synchronization based on events. We see here that now in our dunder init function, we are passing an event in. Yeah, so the event is created not as an instance of one object, but it's shared between multiple objects. This is why we need to pass it in. And then we just set it here in the dunder init function. In the run function, we are now checking for the thread ID. This is also something that we pass in here. And then if the thread ID equals one, we just start blocking. So we just put it to sleep. And then after we have blocked it, we do a self E, yeah, so the event that we passed in here, then we just set it, yeah, and then it's basically ending the blocking behavior. And the other thread ID 2, print start waiting for process, and then while the event is not set, it will have this event is set equals self e.wait2. Yeah, so it will then wait 2 seconds and then it will print the state of the event. So whether it's true or false, this internal flag, this is returned by this function. And then this is done, this is the probing that I talked about before. Yeah, so now you need to check, okay, is it true or false? And then either you can do your processing or you need to wait. And this is why you are running in this loop here until it's safe for you. So until the flag is set and you can continue with your processing. And as mentioned before, the event, it's shared between two threads. Yeah, so it cannot be an instance of one thread. It cannot be created as an instance of one thread object here in the dunder init function. It has to be created outside in the main thread. And then we are just passing it as arguments for our thread objects in here. Yeah, we see one is blocking, that's with the ID one, and the other one is non-blocking. This is the one which is probing. Then we are starting these two threads. Now we see something new. This is this join. Join is also some communication which takes place. So this is a barrier, and the main thread will, as we have seen before, it starts the thread and it continues running, right? But with this join, this is a barrier where the main thread then waits here until thread one has finished its computation, right? When we have seen, you can check whether a thread is active or not. So the main thread, which is running this code, will wait on this line until thread one is not active anymore, until this probing is false. And then it will continue to this line, and then it will probe for thread two, whether this is still running or not. And the last line is then this print exiting. And because we are spawning two threads and we are joining them, we have for each thread a barrier for our main thread. We can, or I mean, we already know that the last output that we see has to be this exiting. Yeah, and we can now check whether this is true. The output is we start blocking and then we have waiting process. We start another thread and then we are now printing this state of this internal flag of our event, which is shared between these two thread objects. And then we see false doing other things, right? False doing other things, false doing other things, right? This is always this part here. We are now in this loop here, in this thread, because this thread is put to sleep. It will not run. It will not use any resources of your interpreter where these threads are running in. And it will just always probe and then do other things, right? This is what we see here. Do other things, do other things, do other things. Now these 10 seconds are up, right? You see this? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 times it has probed because we set it to 2 seconds. This time is up. The other thread now can be put back to life it ends the blocking, it sets this internal flag to true, and then we can do our processing that we wanted, and then we can exit. Yeah, this exiting was the last line that we wanted to see. We have also the option of using a simpler mechanism called locking. It's quite simple, right? I mean, you probably all know this. Threading.lock is another class, and this is very similar to a mutex, right? Or let's say a gate or a door. So when you want to go to the toilet, you want to be alone. So you go in, you close the door. Nobody else can go in. You can do your processing. And when you're finished and it's safe for another one to come in, you can release or open the door again. And then somebody else gets in, right? And this is exactly what you have here with acquire and release. It's a simpler mechanism. We have just this one internal state again. And you are also passing this along in your thread class. And if one thread then calls this acquire for a lock object, all the other threads which are also calling acquire have to wait until the first thread then calls the release, so opens the door again. It looks similarly easy, I would say. We are not now using threading.event, but threading.lock. And you can simply modify your run function. So, of course, you also need to modify your dunder-init function because now you're not passing in an event, but you are passing in your lock. But apart from this, you can now just say my lock acquire. You can then print the time and the name of this thread, and then you can release the lock. And you see that in this case, unlike with the case of the events, we don't need to differentiate between the thread with the ID 1, 2, 3, whatever, because all of them are just calling this lock acquire function, and only one will be the first, and all the others which are calling this myLockAcquire function here are then put to sleep. Yeah, they are waiting until the first thread which manages to get to this line calls again the myLock release. Okay, and we see this here. We are starting thread one, we are starting thread two, and we now see that thread one is running first. We have no interrupt here from thread two because it also called this acquire, but it cannot enter this critical section. Yeah, it has to wait until thread one releases it again, and then thread two can run. And this is the part for the multi-threading. Are there any questions so far? Now, so for instance, if we look here, we start always, if we are starting with this code, we are starting with one thread in our interpreter. And it just continues to run from top to bottom. Yeah, so it creates a threading event, and it creates our thread objects, and then it starts the thread objects, and it would now continue, yeah, as we have seen before. It just runs top to bottom. But sometimes we don't want this. Sometimes we want the main thread to wait for other threads to finish, yeah. And for this, we have here a barrier, a join, and this forces the main thread, which is running all of this code, to wait until thread one has finished, yeah. So it waits until thread one has done its computation, which is defined in this run function. And the same is for thread two.join. Yeah, and with this we can do some synchronization between the between threads, subtasks, and the main thread. Yeah. You know, did this answer your question sufficiently, or okay? Yeah, any more questions? Please go ahead. Thread one is set, thread two is out. So I mean, the thread class does not have this set function. So the set here, this is done on the event class. Yeah. And I hope I understand your question correctly. Yeah, so there is no connection. Yeah, these are two different classes with two different internal states. And you see this here, we have if thread one is thread is so if you are calling on this event set, this has no effect directly on this thread object, right? It's just a side effect somewhere else. And if you want to put something to sleep here, then you need to put it directly to sleep. Or if you do here this on the event wait, yeah, then you put the task to sleep. This is this has an internal, as you see here, this time.sleep. This also has it internally. If you put an integer in here, so in seconds, then it will call a sleep function. If you don't do this, then it's a little bit more tricky, because then it actually waits until the blocking has ended, and then it's it continues running. For this, the event class also has some internal list how this works. Super safe. Johannes, I guess so. So it just calls the Dunder init function of the threading thread class here and do all the initialization of this object. Genau. Okay. Any more questions? This is not the case. We can continue with multiprocessing. Multiprocessing now really creates its own independent processes, but this whole configuration thing can be done quite similar compared to the threading module that we had. The multiprocessing class just basically requires you to change from thread process and from threading to multiprocessing. And of course, we are using this down here, threading. So we are using multiprocessing because this is way deprecated. And one simple example, again, this is like the similar thing we had at the beginning. So we are now importing multiprocessing. Yeah, on the second slide that I or third slide that I have shown you, we had this import threading. Yeah, this is a similar idea. We again define my function, which multiplies A and B. And then we are creating two processes. Yeah, with multiprocessing.process, we are giving the target, yeah, my function, and we are providing two arguments here for A and B. And then we start these processes, right? This is completely similar to what we have seen before with the threading class. However, in multi-threading, which we have seen before in this threading module, each thread accesses the same memory. And in multi-processing, the memory is completely separated. Okay, so if we have a result variable, which is a list, and we have now my function, and it just appends a random integer to this result list, we could now run, right, in the same manner as we have seen here before, one time with the target to this function. Yeah, we can now run it one time with multi-threading and one time with multi-processing. And now the question to you, what would you expect? So if I now run this code in the multi-threading context, I use two threads, I use five threads. I put for all five threads my function here as a target. Yeah, I don't need to provide any arguments. It doesn't take one. What would be the result in my main thread? Can you imagine what I mean? You can just type in the chat what you think would be contained in the result list. Okay. Yeah, I agree with you. It would be an element with five arrays. And in the case of multiprocessing, what would you expect there? So instead of this threading.thread, I would now substitute it with multiprocessing.process. What would you expect there? Also an array with five elements? You would expect five arrays with one element. Okay, Pia, can you explain why? Do you have an argument there? Or does somebody else has a different idea? Yeah, you are definitely on the right track here. But you just forgot that the main thread or the main process here is a process itself. So in the when I call here five times multiprocessing.process, I have in total six processes. So I have six result lists existing in six different Python processes, but I'm only probing in this main process, right? And in this main Python process, the result list will be empty, right? Because I haven't called it. Let's have a look at the actual thing that's going on. So in this case, as we have just discussed, so we have multiprocessing.process, and we put the target to my function. We don't have any arguments here, and we call it. Process one starts, process two starts, then we join them. Yes, we have the barrier. In between here, between the start and the join, yeah, in this area, basically, we have now three different Python processes which are running independently at the same time. Okay, and then the main Python process now accesses our result array and it's empty. Why? Because the main process has not called this function, my function, where the result list is actually populated. Okay? This has not only happened in the other processes, but they have completely separated memory. They are doing something else, and then they are just being destroyed. The results are lost. And then I'm doing the same thing with the thread object, with the thread class, again, to my function. I started. Now I have here, I have now, if I would do this probing, this enumerate, yeah, the threading.enumerate, I would see three threads. I need to be careful myself. And yeah, I have one main thread. I have two threads which are running my function. And then I join them and then I print the results. And I see I have now in my main thread, I now have my results in here. How is this possible? Well, I have one Python interpreter which runs Python bytecode from only one thread at a time. And it shares, this is one Python interpreter, it shares the same memory. So all of the threads are working on the same memory, which means because it's a global variable, our result array here, our result list, every thread can access it. Yeah, it's not local to a function, to a target function or something. It's globally available and they can all append to it. Right, and because all of the main thread and the two target my function threads, I hope you know what I mean, yeah, are all using the same memory, they can all append to it and they can read to it and they all share the same state. And this is now where the global interpreter lock comes in, because I mean, you have now 2.5 days of parallelization behind you, and you should know that appending something to a list is a critical section, right? You can have a race condition. You can have two threads which are trying to append something to a list at the same time. And we have not anything done here to prevent this kind of race condition with the threading, right? And you don't need it because, so for instance, if you do this in C, you would need to implement something. But Python provides you with this global interpreter lock, and everything you do with threading.thread is thread safe. Yeah, so every function that has implications or some possible race condition is resolved by this global interpreter lock. And the global interpreter lock means, I just mentioned it shortly, but it really means that only one instance of Python bytecode is executed at the same time. So although we have just seen that we had three different threads running at the same time, only one of them, one of this bytecode parts, was really executed at the same time. So in some sense, it was still serial. Yeah, this is everything due to this global interpreter lock. Can you guess when this makes sense? I mean, I now basically said we are spawning a lot of threads and they are still running sequentially because we can only execute Python bytecode at the same time of one instance, sorry. Can you think of a scenario where we could say, okay, this still makes sense? Yeah, okay, Tim, that's a good argument. Yeah, would make sense. Definitely, if you have different tasks like an IO thread, a GUI thing, exactly what you say. So particularly the GUI is usually not used, yeah, because we humans are so slow. A different example would be if you use modules like NumPy. So NumPy itself often uses libraries like Blast or something similar on your system. And this is then not Python bytecode, right? So when NumPy calls libraries on your system, it leaves the interpreter. It makes a calculation outside of your Python interpreter, and another thread can come in. So if you do very complicated NumPy calculations where you're heavily using your system libraries, you can also see a performance benefit, with the advantage that you are not need to take care of memory synchronization, right? Because you have this global interpreter lock, you can just do this, what we have seen here, you can just append everything to a list. However, I need to continue here because we're running out of time. And it's also very easy actually to do the same thing with multiprocessing, as you will see now. So multiprocessing has also an advantage. You can create pools. Yeah, and this is just, you can just use here multiprocessing, we shorten it to MP, and then you can just use MP or multiprocessing.pool, and then you can now create a pool of workers, with the number of workers that you like, for instance, the number of CPU counts that your current system has. So this is a very generic and portable code snippet here. And each of these worker in this pool can now take over processes which should be processed. And this has the advantage. So before we have seen, we always need to do like process one, process two, process three, different objects which we needed to write down and which we needed to instantiate. And it was not very portable and useful. With this, this is done completely automatically. And now we have on the one side, we have a pool of workers. And on the other side, we have our functions. And we want to parallelize it. So usually, for instance, the input parameters can vary. It's an iterable. And then we can, right, we have these two things. And then we can now, for instance, apply the functions to a certain input range or map it onto each other or star map. And what all of these things mean, we will have a look at now. If you already know apply and map from the internal Python functions, they are similar, but they are optimized in a certain way that they can be executed in parallel on a pool of workers. So, example one here, this uses apply, calling apply executes a single function on this pool. Yeah, we see down here, we are importing multiprocessing. We have again our famous myFunction. We are now creating a pool of workers. And now we have here our result. And we see here, we have a list comprehension. And what we do is we use our pool of workers and we apply our target function, my function, with arguments. And in this case, we have an iterable here. We have okay, sorry, that was the wrong mouse button. Now you should see my mouse again. Sorry. So here we are iterating, we have a list comprehension, we are iterating over an iterable about a range from 1 to 100. And we are passing in different arguments in here. And then we are basically creating now a total of 99 functions. And they are then mapped or applied on this pool of workers. And you see that we use a list comprehension here. And this means actually in our main process, We have then at the end, after we do this pool close, so this is also like a barrier, we are now waiting that this computation here has taken place for our main process, and then we can print the results. And multiprocessing with this pool apply function here has now provided a very convenient way with which we could collect the results from all of these different independent processes, which have their own memory space, which operate completely independent and parallel. And we can now gather all of this. And you can see here, it's even ordered, yeah, because we use the normal apply function. And we have gathered all of this. So it's a very convenient way. Map is now a little bit different. It takes one iterable as argument and executes processes for each iterable. What does this mean? Everything here stays the same. The difference is just here in the results line. So we have again our pool, and then we map my function on an iterable, right? Before the arguments were fixed, now we are passing in an iterable. So we move this list comprehension in here in this as an argument for our map function. And we again see that we get the result is the same, right? So for this very simple example, it makes no difference. Example 3, star map. It also takes one iterable as an argument, but each iterable can itself be iterable. Okay, so we see here again that we are now passing in using a list comprehension a pair of two integers, and the pair is of course also iterable. So this is different to the last one. Here we could only pass with this map, we could only pass one argument, one integer into here, into this map function. Here now we can use with star map, we can use an iterable, yeah, so a number of input variables for our function. You see again here, it's also ordered again, the output. How is it made ordered? Well, it's executed synchronously. Basically, there's no other way. However, we can also do it asynchronously. And for this, all these functions, which we have seen before, apply, map, star map, have all these underscore async functions. And now the output of the individual job is not ordered. And this, however, works much faster because, of course, it now can utilize the full parallel capacity of your system and can calculate everything in parallel. And afterwards, in the main process, you can just call apply result get. And for this, you also need to define a callback routine, which is an argument, for instance, of your apply async or your map async. And this is then called after all jobs finished. Yeah. So you have again a synchronization barrier there. How does this look like? Everything is the same with the pool. We have our results objects. Yeah. We are now, this is important differentiation. Before we had our results, the things that our target function returned, we had it in one array. Now what we get with this asynchronous thing is we get result objects. And we can see the rest stays the same. In this case, we are using apply async, and so we have this like large list comprehension, which you can see here. And in the end, we need to get our results. For this, we are also using a list comprehension. So for every result object in the this list of result objects, which we got from this asynchronous execution, we are using the get function, and then this result object just looks the same. Then we are closing the pool again, and it's fine. Okay, last thing is the callback function. Still my very famous my function. And now we want, we define this callback function, which is called collect result. It uses one argument, and we define on the main process, we define a global variable results. And then we adjust to this global variable, we are just appending the individual result. Yeah, so very simple, basically. And this now allows us that we can loop. Yeah, we are now not using this implicit looping mechanism, yeah, which you have in a list comprehension, although you have this explicit loop in there, but it now looks a little bit more like a loop. Yeah. You are looping over your apply asynchronous, and then you are just using your callback function here, and then you are just storing all of your results in your global results list. And then you can close it and you can print it. Okay. Multiprocessing. Do you have any questions to this part? Please go ahead. Okay, no questions. And for me, the important thing is that somehow you really understood the difference between threading and processing, and also the implications of this global interpreter log. So if you somehow feel uncomfortable, please just ask. Asynchronous execution is actually usually faster. When we want to use it, yeah. For instance, if you have functions where the execution time depends heavily on your input parameters, right? This, I think there you can see a big impact, but you can always just do small benchmarks and see what's happening. Usually asynchronous execution is faster. Okay, any more questions? Yeah, good point, of course. Genau, so it's not only like that based on the input arguments of a function that the execution time can differ, but also what Jonathan just wrote, if you are using I/O a lot and some other things which might have an impact on the execution time of a single function, then this of course is also always a good idea to do it asynchronously. It's usually, if you always have like a fixed execution time, you will see not such a big difference. If for some reasons you have a different execution time, you will see a huge difference. Okay, I saw some typing, but not anymore. Yeah, we managed to get through in 1 hour. If you want to ask one more question, either now or... Okay, no typing, then I think we should continue. So you have now tutorial one for this... Python part, where we are going to learn a little bit about Anaconda. which is very useful in managing Python environments. And there you also will now use threading and multiprocessing to calculate pi. Now I think we can now basically go into the breakout rooms, and I will go from room to room and see if you have any questions or problems, and then try to help. If you have any questions, you can also just write me here in BBB or Rocket Chat. And I would say we start now with this practical. If you don't find it, you can also write here. Now continue with Python and MPI. Now this is a refresher for you since you already had it this morning, but I think I can still give you one or two more insights. Now, since I didn't know exactly what you already learned, just a small repetition. MPI is for a distributed memory system. So in the last 2 hours, we spent our processing parallelization techniques on a single node, which means one single processor here, which can consist of multiple cores, of course, and one memory, right? So we were just spending our time on this single node, and now we want to go to MPI. So we want to use it for a distributed memory system, and therefore we are using now some kind of interconnect. And what we are now going to do is we want to exchange messages from one system to another. The execution of an MPI program is also rather simple, I would guess. You can just launch an MPI parallelized Python script, as you have learned this morning, with MPI run or MPI exec, and then you can pass in this option dash n and then some integer. And this is a number of processes that you start, and this n this is a number of individual and independent Python interpreters that you start up. Okay, so if you start with MPI run dash n 5, and then you do your Python, my Python script.py, then you are starting 5 independent interpreters, which will just move through your code from top to bottom as every other Python script would do, right? And then you can put them in something that we call a communicator, right? You can see this here. And if you are now working on a cluster, you can see also that these, depending on what you configure with Slurm, of course, you already also learned this, they can be on different nodes located. So they could be sharing a node, and they also could be on different nodes that you need to use your communicator. Okay, ranks and communicator, you probably already learned this, but just for repetition, because you're going to need it in the exercise, the rank. Each process, each of those Python interpreters that you start has a unique ID, which is given to them by the MPI library, by OpenMPI, if you use it, And this can be used to distinguish one process from the other. A communicator groups processes together, and you can use a communicator for communication, as the name already suggests. So, and communication always takes place in the communicator, and you should vary that. The rank of a process can be different in different communicators. We see one example down here. So first of all, we import MPI from MPI for Pi, Then we initialize our ComWorld communicator. This is this one communicator thing that you always need to have. The ComWorld contains all processes. Yeah, so there, everything is in there. And then you can get the size. This is the number of processes which you have in total. This is the same as your dash N option, which you put in with MPI run or MPI exec. And you can also here use a get rank. And what you can do, because you are starting independent Python interpreters, which are executing the exact same code, is that you can do if statements. So if rank equals zero, then do something, because this rank, this variable, this is the only thing that differs between all of these processes at the beginning. Okay, sending and receiving. Very simple. We have an example here. We want to send a dictionary to one process to the other. So we initialize our MPI com world. We get the rank. And then we say, okay, if we have rank zero, then initialize data. Data is a dictionary. Yeah, A, B, C, and it contains an integer, and a string. On the other process, if we start two processes, this is rank one, we will receive some information and then we will print it. Yeah. How does this send and receive look like? We use our ComWorld communicator, which we initialized up here. And then we have a send function here. And in the send function, we put in the data that we want to send. We put the destination, so the rank, the process where we want to send our data to. And we can also provide a tag. And on the other side, on the receiving end of this message, we do a comReceive. From where? From source zero. Yeah, this is always, again, the rank from where we are getting it. And we need to make sure that we have the same tag here. And you can now see that we are printing the data that we receive here. And if we do an MPI run, dash N2, Python 3, MPI example 1.py, you see here that we are receiving the exact dictionary which we sent here, yeah? So although we did not initialize this dictionary on the process with rank one, we only did it on rank zero, we have it available after this communication on rank one. Yeah. So we can really exchange our objects. Okay. So in summary, so we can arbitrary Python objects. Yeah, we have seen it now for a dictionary, but we can do this for arbitrary Python objects. They can be sent and received without the manual need for serialization from the user. Yeah. And what does this mean? MPI function, send, receive, broadcast, everything that you already learned. Under the hood, they pickle an object, yeah. Pickling is Python language for serializing an object. So the object that you have in memory, in your volatile memory, which has a certain state, which depends on the execution status of your program, this can be serialized, yeah, pickled, and then sent to a different Python interpreter. Quite cool, I think. And again, we see here data. This is a Python object that you want to send. You have destination, so the rank of the process where you want to send it, and the tag. And this is an arbitrary ID for this message. Yeah. And with this, you can send several messages from the same process to the other same process, and you can differ between them, yeah, just based on this idea. You don't need to look into the message itself, actually. And therefore, on the receiving end, you need to provide the rank from the process that you want to have it, and you also need to get the ID right. And the return value of the receive function, this is the data that was sent. Yeah, this is a pickled object. So on the one side, you pickle it. You break it down to a byte stream. You send it over, and then the other Python interpreter takes the pickled object and creates a functioning normal Python object again from it and returns this as a return value for this function. There are also non-blocking functions. I send, I receive. I guess this is what you already learned this morning, so I won't go into this. Genau, as I already said, objects need to be serialized to a byte stream when they need to be sent. Yeah, and this includes quite some overhead for this communication, and particularly in scientific computing, yeah, it's necessary to, on the one hand, exchange large amounts of data, but on the other side, to really be fast with your computation, this also needs to be quick. Yeah, and for this reason, there is for continuous NumPy arrays, there is a special way of communication which largely reduces this pickling overhead, and they are quite easy to differentiate from the normal ones because they only use this first letter capitalized. Yeah, so instead of a small s for send and receive, you now have capitalized S and R for send and receive, yeah? And this is one of the points that differentiates them. Since we are now not, as before, pickling our entire NumPy array down and sending it as a byte stream to our receiving function, building it up there and then giving back this return value, we need to initialize our NumPy array on both ends, yeah? So also the receiving process needs to initialize beforehand a NumPy array with the exact length, yeah? And this pre-initialized NumPy array is then populated with the data which is sent. And we will have a look at an example here. So again, we import MPI for Pi, we import now NumPy. This is something that only works with NumPy. Yeah, it's very specific to this and it's very cool. We use our convert communicator, we get our rank, and then we want to send again from rank 0 to rank 1, we want to send a NumPy array. Yeah, so in rank 1, we initialize our data, NumPy A range, 100 fields of type NumPy float. Yeah, I think this is deprecated now. I think now you only are supposed to write float because NumPy switched from this own NumPy dot something data types to the official Python types. But this is exactly here the idea. You initialize here your NumPy array and then you use the communicator as before, send with a capitalized S, yeah? And then you send again the data, you provide the destination, the rank of the process you are sending to, and a tag. And now the difference here is, on the receiving side, you need to initialize your data structure beforehand. We see here we do a NumPy empty 100 of the same NumPy float data type. Yeah. So we have now in memory the same data structure, the same NumPy array, the same, yeah, which is a Python object with the correct length. And now we are passing in this in our receive function with a capitalized R. We provide the correct source, the correct tag, and then this works. Yeah. So in summary, send receive can be used for completely generic Python object. It pickles them down to a byte stream, sends them over, they are built up on the other side again, and you can then use them there. On the other side, send receive with a capitalized S or R. This is used for continuous arrays, and it's very, very fast. This is something in the exercise which you are going to do. You are actually going to benchmark this. How much faster is this? I have done this already on our system here, and I can tell you it's one order of magnitude, actually, what you are saving here in communication overhead. Of course, you also have the option to do collective communication. You have the option to broadcast something. So one process can broadcast its data to all other processes. Yeah, so rank zero broadcasts its information to 1, 2, 3, 4 processes with these ranks. You see here, we can again, also with these collective communications, we can use arbitrary Python objects. Yeah, in this case, again, just a simple dictionary, which contains a list and here a tuple. And rank zero now broadcasts this data. Yeah, and the root here is zero. So we see here only the rank zero process is initializing this data structure, this object. And the root communicator here is also the process zero who has this and then data. And we said here else data equals none. Yeah. And then the data is pickled on process zero, sent to all other, built up there. Why do we need to have this data equals none? Yeah, otherwise, you are referencing data before assignment. This is this typical exception that you get. Scattering is basically the same idea. In this case, we use the list comprehension to initialize a list containing the squares of integers, and we are scattering them to these other processes. And now we are just giving not every other process, we give it not all information, but we give only parts to other processes. Yeah, as you can see here, I think you already learned this morning, so I'm going over it a little bit faster. If it's too fast and you want to have a repetition, you can just write in the chat. Genau, you see also here, we have this data equals none, that we don't get this exception. And we can then also assert that our data fits on each of these processes, because this assert, again, is computed, it's interpreted on each independent process. Gather works the other way around. Each process has independent data, and one process is gathering it and putting it together to a single data structure. Yeah, so data equals rank plus one square, and now we do a gather on root zero, and only the process with rank zero now has this completed data structure, and we can loop over it, yeah, and assert that we actually have the data as a list, yeah, available on process zero, because this is our root here, yeah, we have a normal list here, and we can assert that it's the correct data which we initialized up here. Yeah. We have the same also with NumPy arrays, and probably you all know what you have to do. If ring zero, if you want to have again this broadcast for collective communication, rank zero, broadcast to all others. You initialize a NumPy A range here of type integer. And all the other processes here now have also NumPy empty. Yeah? with the same length of the same type. It's not as before where we had this none. We need to initialize, we need to allocate our memory, our data structure beforehand. And now we can do a broadcast with a capitalized B here, com.bcast, yeah, with data and the root, who has this data initialized, and then we can assert that all the data is correct. The same logic holds true with scattering. Rank 0 initializes the send buffer, yeah. We see here that we initialize an empty send buffer, and we have all the other processes have a receive buffer of the same length as here, yeah, as in the send buffer. We do a communication, a com scatter. Of what? What do we scatter? We scatter the send buffer to all the receive buffers from root 0. Okay, and then we can again assert if the receive buffers are, here we have made an all close, yeah. This is like an equal, but it has some, yeah. It allows for minor deviations with the rank. Gather works exactly the same. Yeah. We have our send buffer. Everyone initializes it. The receive buffer here is now none. And only the process here, which gathers all the information, now needs to pre-initialize, as we always do with these NumPy communications. We need to initialize our NumPy object beforehand. We do it here. Then we can gather, and then we can assert on rank 0 if we all catch the right data. Okay, cool topics with Python and MPI, of course, exceptions and deadlocks. When you import MPI for Py, and I don't know how much you know about Python, but when you write import something and you execute this code, then usually these modules have --- init, dunder init file, and this is actually executed by your Python interpreter. Yeah, so a lot of code is running there, and part of this code and part of MPI for Py already takes care that MPI is automatically initialized for you. Yeah, so you can already just import your MPI for Py, and then you can already assert that your MPI com world get size is larger 1. Yeah, this works because it's already done in the dunder init file. And this, however, leads to an interesting side effect. So we now want to provoke an exception. Okay, so we initialize our MPI for Py automatically. We provoke an exception on rank 0 with divided by 0 exception, yeah, 0 division error here. So we can never do this MPI send what we want to do here. Yeah, you can also see that what Python object do I want to send? None. Yeah, but I wanted to send from rank 0 to rank 1. Yeah, a message containing none with the tag 42. But before we got here, we had an exception. And what is now happening? We have a deadlock. Yeah, with this MPI run here, what you can see here, MPI 1-n10 Python deadlock example.py. When we execute this, we are spawning 10 independent Python interpreters. Yeah, they are completely independent. This exception this zero division exception here is only thrown on one of these Python interpreters, yeah, on Python interpreter with a Python with a rank zero, yeah. All the others are fine; they are continuing to run. And now we have the problem that the one with rank one is waiting for a message from rank zero, and it has no knowledge about an exception there because these are individual Python interpreters. And then we have actually a deadlock. Yeah, this is cannot happen in any other language, or at least not in C and Fortran and what you have seen this morning. This is completely unique to Python. So just keep this in mind. Okay, to make things more complicated, but maybe also a little bit more interesting, you can do dynamic process management. So this is possible since MPI2, and it provides process models, which allows to create new processes and to establish communication between them and the existing MPI application. This is useful for sequential applications, which are built on top of parallel modules, or if we have a client-server module. So I have one example here. We see here we have an MPI comself in this case, and then we spawn a system executable with an argument scipy.py, and we say max processes 5. Yeah, this requires that you have the scipy.py. This is the script that you have already written that lies there in your path. Okay, and then because it's an executable, you probably need to have this magic line. So hashtag exclamation mark bin Python, yeah, that it's interpreted as an executable. And then you can here create your NumPy array. You can then use a NumPy specific, this NumPy specific capitalized bcast. And you can then send this NumPy array around. And then you can have here the option, and this is again something for this dynamic process management. Unique, you have now something called MPI root. So this process, which is spawning the other processes. Yeah, this is called the root process, and you can refer to it as MPI root. Afterwards, you can do a reduce. Yeah, so you can gather all the information again. And here, to which process can you gather it? Yeah, also to root, right? And then you can disconnect here. Yeah, you can kill the other processes. You see this here, this communicator where we spawned the other ones. You're disconnecting and done. Next example, or even last example, we can, this is now the part, okay, sorry. We called here the scipy.py Python script. Yeah, and this is now the other part. This is the scipy.py. So this is, oops, so this is the root, as I said, the MPI root script, which is called the scipy.py script. This is shown here. And here now we can actually use again this get MPI communicator, get parent. This is in the communicator, and they have within this communicator, again, this is quite interesting, you have again the size into rank. And then you can also on this side, you need to provide the contra functions for what you are using in the other script, in your MPI root script. Yeah, we have seen there, we have seen bcast. And we also need to implement this here on our children script, yeah? And then we can do some calculations here. In this case, we are calculating pi. And then we save pi here as a NumPy array. And then we are using, yeah, in parallel as we did here with the comReduce. We can then send to root. We can reduce our result for pi And also here we need to disconnect from this communicator. Okay. So if you are using this, you are getting around this MPI run dash N, blah, blah, blah. In this particular example where we are just calculating pi, I think it's not so useful. But as I mentioned in this server client application world, this is basically what you can do. Yeah, any questions so far?